is truly my utmost pleasure to be here with you this morning to chair a most seminal lecture in honor of the most honorable Hugh Lawson Shearer, in his memory. And I'd like to congratulate all of you for your commitment to not only your profession, but also to the exploration and remedying of the ills which we all face as the Jamaican people. The import of this lecture, the twin challenge of diabetes and menopause, cannot be downplayed. And I know that we all quite look forward to hearing it, especially as we commemorate the most honorable Hugh Lawson Shearer, who himself not only championed healthcare in Jamaica as a trade unionist, as a human rights activist, as a prime minister, but also as someone who was able to live successfully with diabetes for over 50 years. So thus, without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, I wish to announce, to read a little bit, to introduce you to a presenter and awardee with whom you're all familiar, Ms. Faye Whitbourne Morrison. And before the esteemed lady takes the stage, I shall introduce her. Dr. Faye Whitbourne Morrison is an honors graduate in medicine from the University of London, UCWI campus. Following her internship, she pursued a diploma course in laboratory medicine at the University of the West Indies. Our awardee has a most distinguished academic career spanning 4 decades and spent nearly 3 decades as a consultant to both public and private laboratories. Her last post in the field was as a director of the National Laboratory Service, Ministry of Health. In 2000, she retired from government service and made a decision to return to clinical practice. Then, she has since honed her skills in diabetes management and practices at the Diabetes Center in Kingston. You're all aware of that, I'm sure. Yes, no? No, we can't go in with low energy, ladies and gentlemen, because after that rousing presentation, we cannot let down the side. So are we all aware of this? You know, I'm really an attorney, so I was really hoping that you're a little bit more interesting and energetic than we are. Over the years, Dr. Whitbourne Morrison has given over 70 presentations on menopause to various groups. She's married. Do we know who she's married to? I just met the gentleman. He's not too bad. She's married to Professor Errol Morrison, and between them, they have 7 wonderful daughters. The University Diabetes Outreach Program recognizes Dr. Whitbourne Morrison for her outstanding contribution to the field of family medicine and being a trailblazer. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm sure you would agree with me, and I'm going to ask you to say it with me, and being a trailblazer. Can we be a little bit more impressive? You know, this really, really, I really was hoping that this would not be like continuing professional legal development. And being a trailblazer. In the field of menopause management. So I'm going to ask you to put your hands together as we invite her to the stage to make a very important presentation on this twin challenge of diabetes and menopause.
Thank you very much.
Before the honorable lady takes the stage, there will be a presentation of a plaque. No, you go ahead. And I would like everybody to put their hands together. So at the time of the presentation, there can be a rousing applause so as to properly honor her contribution to your field and to our country, which is extremely pivotal and important. So ladies and gentlemen. Ladies Ladies and gentlemen, we welcome to the podium at this time for the Hugh, Shearer, Lawson Lecture, Dr. Faye Whitbourne Morrison.
Thank you, Ashley Ann. It's really a pleasure. First of all, good morning, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen. You know, it's really, I'm honored to have been asked to give this lecture in honor of the most honorable Hugh Lawson Shearer, who lived with diabetes, as you have heard, for most of his adult life, and was passionate about the welfare of the elderly. And he did everything in his power to promote and to improve their quality of life. Throughout his long career, so it wasn't just one part of it, as a trade unionist, as a politician, and as a prime minister. So this morning, I wish I could say my presentation is going to be as hilarious as the one that you just had, but I hope you'll find a little humor in it here and there. Today we're going to talk about menopause and diabetes, and I'm going to give a fairly lengthy presentation on menopause, then a short presentation on andropause. Who knows what andropause is? Oh wow, we have done a good job. We have educated the public. And last of all, we'd speak about how diabetes and menopause are linked. So the first question I think people want to know is, what is menopause? There's a fair amount of confusion. And you probably know or don't know that it's a landmark time in a woman's life when her period ceases. Now, it's not just a cease any old way. She has not to see her period for 12 consecutive months before you can diagnose that she has reached menopause. And the age range is usually between 45 and 55. And it's really, most women have their menopause about 51, 53, that sort of range. But it's somewhat unpredictable. And the closest we have come to some kind of scientific way of determining it is the time that her mother had her menopause. Otherwise, we just guess, we're not sure when it's going to be. But we know, again, it's influenced by genetics as the mother part. We also know that cigarette smoking will bring it on 2 years earlier. And if you don't know, I'm telling you that it's good to hold on to your female hormones for as long as you can, if you have a choice. And so, as you know, it's a time of estrogen deficiency. I think I'm going in the wrong direction. You know, am I? No, let's try again. Okay, menopause is natural in most cases, but it can be induced, such as when a woman has a hysterectomy and her ovaries are also taken, or if she has cancer and has to have chemotherapy, which is damaging to many organs, including the sex organs. And it can be premature if it occurs before age 40. And then these are just terms I want you to get clear because it's a bit confusing. And then we use the word perimenopause, which means the years around the menopause, and then the postmenopause, all the years after menopause. And I make this emphasis because a lot of women think that when they go through the so-called passage, life changes, goes back to how it was before, but it really doesn't. There are changes that occur that stay with us pretty much for the rest of our lives. But we don't have to be worried about them because they're solutions for almost everything that a woman faces. Now, the first thing that she notices a change in her periods. They start coming closer together or further apart, or the flow changes. But that's usually that is what we see. And the duration of the period may change from 5 days, what it used to be, to much longer. So we divide menopause artificially into three terms. the early, the medium, and the long term. But they merge together, so it's really artificial. And we know that it's the cessation of periods, and the hallmark which most women complain about are the hot flashes or hot flushes. And the hot flushes occur in about 75% of women to a lesser or greater extent. Or if they don't have hot flushes or hot flashes, they have what we call heat intolerance. And that heat intolerance, maybe just that the woman feels hot in a room which is cool, maybe everybody might be pulling on a sweater, but this woman is hot. And of course, there are other things like the mood swings, the difficulty sleeping. If a woman, maybe I should say, what is a hot flash? A hot flash, because some women are confused. The classic hot flash is a feeling of heat that starts in the chest, comes up to the neck, and the face gets flushed. The woman breaks out in a big sweat, and then her heart sometimes races, or she doesn't feel too great for a couple seconds, and then it all dies down again. In the heat intolerance, she doesn't really sweat, she just feels hot. Now, you can imagine if you're a stush executive, CEO of a big company, you know, and you're in the boardroom, and you're the only female, you've broken the glass ceiling, and you're the only female in the room, and all these gentlemen are in their jackets looking very, you know, super, and you start sweating, and you sweat so much that you ask to be excused. It can be very inconvenient. So it depends on, you know, the sort of situation you may find yourself in. And some women will tell you, Lord, doc, I have to travel with a rug, you know, because I can't take it. So it can be annoying. But, and then I will mention later that it does have some other significance. Now, there are other things like the psychological symptoms, the irritability. You know, it used to be known that, Lord, she's going through a menopause, you know, and so she'd dry up and look miserable. So fatigue, a lot of women complain about fatigue. Some even complain about a crawling sensation on their body. You look, you know, sinalize. So, you know, you have to accommodate all these different complaints that women have. In fact, some women don't have a classic hot flash. They tell me they have heat all in their belly or anywhere else. So you listen and you acknowledge that you have heard, because we're all different. Now, also is the genital urinary syndrome. And this syndrome really has to do with the loss of estrogen in the pelvic organs. And you know, the estrogen is what makes women's pelvic organs work well and flourish. So when you lose it, things begin to happen. A little droopiness, a little lack of tightness, a little dryness. And this can have a major effect on a woman's life, especially her sex life. So these hot flashes, I think I've already described. But, and also the psychological symptoms, I think I'm going in the wrong direction. No, I think I've got the right direction. So these hot flashes, I thought, well, for some time, at one of the conferences I went to, they mentioned that was being researched because they thought there might have been more to it. We used to be taught that it's just that the brain is a little confused, the heat regulating center is a little off, that's why women have these hot flashes in a cool environment. But since then, there have been some studies done using flow-mediated dilatation. In this study of 272 women, ages 40 to 60, and they found that the younger age group, the 40 to 47 age group, that there was an association between hot flashes and endothelial function. And they thought this may have had some other further importance. But there was no association found between hot flashes and vascular dysfunction in the older age group. I don't know why this doesn't flow. Oh, because I'm pressing the wrong thing. Let's see, hot flashes. So hot flashes, this is now a comment from a very important lady, Dr. Joanne Pinkerton, who is the executive director of the North American Menopause Society. And I have to tell you, that's the leading authority on menopause, I think, in the world. So when they speak, we listen. And she commented that hot flashes are just not a nuisance. They're linked to cardiovascular, bone, and brain health. Now, we really don't want to hear that because we don't have any control over it. But it may be a trigger to tell us that we need to do something positive, like eating right, exercising, very important for cardiovascular health, so we won't be too daunted with this. Now, hot flashes, we can do something else about it. Most women will be able to tell you what the triggers are. They'll tell you, if I have coffee, alcohol, if I get too stressed out, if I dress too hot in a jacket and all that, and the place is hot. So most women, if you ask them, they'll be able to tell you some things that bring it on. And so you advise them to avoid those triggers. But obviously, not everybody can avoid every trigger. So there are a number of medications that we can use that are available to us. And some of the antidepressants fit that bill, and they can be quite useful. And now more recently, well, we know hormone therapy, which I've mentioned, is most effective. But what I realize is that women are thoroughly against hormone therapy. They don't want to hear the word. So what do? We can advise them, we can help them, and we can see if we can find an alternative. So I'm just going a little more into the psychological symptoms, the mood swings. Now, this is very distressing to the family. The mother, who has been a fairly calm individual, begins to cry for no reason. And the children don't know what's wrong. And then she gets out of it and she's fine. So the mood swings can be quite distressing for the family members and for the woman herself. And I already mentioned the irritability. And some women actually have panic attacks. They don't want to leave the house. They're afraid of a lot of things. They get very anxious. And you have to try and calm them and deal with them and give appropriate medication as they need. And some actually go into frank depression. Now, usually the women who have had an episode of depression before are the ones who develop what we call clinical depression, and they have to be treated. Now, some of the mood swings that we and irritability, we have also learned that women who have the night sweats, you have hot flashes and night sweats. Women who have the night sweats where they wake up or they're awakened by it, and the night clothes is wet, and they have to get up and change, and then they go back to bed, and if it happens two or three times in a night, you can see how disturbing this can be. And most people, if you are awakened two, three times in a night, you're going to feel tired in the morning. So a woman told me she actually has to sleep with a towel on her bed. So it can be quite profuse and quite exhausting. And again, we're called the sandwich generation, because we find we're in a position where we have to care our elderly parents and our children at the same time. And a lot of women work as well, and so there's quite a bit of stress in their lives. And that can create some of the anxiety. And of course, not to mention the emptiness syndrome. The emptiness syndrome is that household that used to have 3-4 children running up and down the place, excitement, full of ideas, what they're going to do. Mommy, have you seen this? What do you think of this outfit? Gone. Mommy's there alone, or with a husband who might not come in too often or provide a lot of companionship. And she's no longer important. Nobody's asking her opinion on anything. And so some of these things can also contribute to this loneliness, this distress that women have at this time. There's also the cognitive behavioral therapy. If the doctor who sees the patient thinks that this person needs further or more professional help, you can refer them where they can get this help. And of course, the antidepressants combined are very, with or without the therapy, are very useful. Now, let's talk a little bit about the medium term, the genitourinary syndrome. In the old terminology, we used to say atrophic vaginitis. We no longer use those terms. This is now genitourinary syndrome. And actually, as women age, a number of them do end up with vaginal dryness because of the loss of estrogen. And this leads to dyspareunia, is a word which just means painful sex. And it can cause the woman to avoid sex. And if she has a partner, he doesn't understand this in many cases. And he thinks she has found a lover somewhere else. That's the usual thing. She have a man. So there's need for education. And we were very pleased when men used to come with their women folks to our meetings so we could educate them. And I've also had the pleasure of having husbands bringing their wives for counseling and for understanding, just to understand what is happening. Because both genders do age and it has some consequences. So apart from this dyspareunia, some women get itching in the genital area, and there's absolutely miserable thing called incontinence. Now, what is incontinence? It's the involuntary loss of urine. You don't want to lose it at a wrong place. You want to keep it where it should be and dispose of it in the proper place. So for these conditions, there are a number of solutions again. For the dry vagina, the woman can go to a pharmacy and go to the female section, and you'll find any number of lubricants. Now they have warming lubricant, all kind of lubricants. I've been reliably informed that coconut oil works very well as well. So you can find something. Now, if that doesn't work, we do have estrogen tablets in some form. Well, I'm going to tell you, a lot of the things we have lost because from the, well, I'll go back, Women's Health Initiative study went across the world on TV. Anybody remembers that study that said estrogen was going to give you breast cancer? Who remembers that study? 2002, every corner of the world, women don't want estrogen again, but it has a very valuable use. So generally, we treat with vaginal estrogen, and it may come in a cream like Premarin. I think a lot of people would know what Premarin is. Or it may come in tablets, which we don't have in Jamaica, or it may come in a ring that used to be inserted vaginally for 3 months at a time, very convenient, gone from Jamaica. So we have lost a lot of those things, but I'll tell you what is available, some here and some not here. And then you have these new medications, very interesting drugs. They're called designer drugs. Who has heard of designer drugs? We have had a few, tamoxifen, raloxifene. We have had a few of those drugs which are custom made to produce the effect that you really want and hopefully to avoid the ill effects of the similar drug. So they're called selective estrogen receptor modulators. And recently, they have developed this one called ospemifene, which has been found to be very useful in treating vaginal dryness. And according to the North American Menopause Society, low-dose estrogen just used in the vagina is the best form of treatment because you avoid, if the woman has a uterus, you avoid the need for giving her a progesterone as well, or progestin as well. But it has side effects. Although it's custom-made and is a designer drug, it has some side effects which can also be undesirable. So what are the drugs that are used for treating and used in hormone therapy? The estrogen we mentioned, the progesterone, and these new drugs called SERMs. And they have also developed another serum called basidoxifene, which has the very valuable because it saves you from osteoporosis. It's a bone builder, but it also and it has a negative effect on the womb. Maybe I should back up a little and say, when we're using hormone therapy, if the woman does not have her womb, you can use estrogen alone. If the woman has her uterus, you have got to use a progestin along with it to prevent the endometrial lining inside from building up, and this woman may go on to get uterine cancer. So it's very important. So most times, you have to bear that in mind all the time when you think of offering a woman hormone therapy. So because neither of the treatments were perfect, because the estrogen given to a woman with a uterus we call endometrial hyperplasia, then and they found from this big study, Women's Health Initiative study, that progesterone can produce negative effects that you don't really want. So they worked again and came up with this basidoxifene, described as a third generation SERM. It acts like an estrogen agonist, means it has a powerful positive effect on bone and no effect on the endometrium. So it was coming pretty good, close to perfect. And then somebody else thought, well, let's add Premarin to it. And the combination is called, well, in some countries, it's called Duovive. And it's used for treating osteoporosis and menopausal symptoms without the need for having to give a progesterone. And I think I mentioned that hormone therapy can come in tablets, patches, always better if you have patches. That's again flown from Jamaica. Creams, so any of the drug houses who would like to help us to better be able to manage menopausal women, we'd be glad to hear from you. And it comes in many forms. And then I mentioned this study. It was a big study put on by the American U.S. Health Institute. Thank you, Institute. And it enrolled over 160 women, 160,000 women altogether. And there was the ages were between 50 and 59, I should say, 79. The range was 50 to 79, and they had an arm for hormone therapy. Well, I want to back up a little and say, at that time, the 80s, the late 80s and early 90s, there was a thought that they looked at women and women's health, and they said, oh, women don't get heart attacks till they're about 65. What is it that prevents them from getting it then? It's their hormones, the estrogen. So when the estrogen fails at midlife, let's give them some more to keep them going. But they found that the women were developing a lot of problems, mainly breast cancer. So they were interested in knowing really what was really important in women's health. What should we look for? What should we give women? Also, it was a time when all the research that was being done on men only. So there was this need to really look at women and women's health. And so they had this arm of the study called the hormone study, in which they looked at the effect of estrogen alone and estrogen and progesterone. And the results were mixed, because in the arm with the progesterone, they found an increase in breast cancer, and that was what caused the problem. Increase in coronary heart disease, strokes, pulmonary emboli. But there was also a positive side. Colorectal cancer went down, endometrial cancer went down, hip fractures went down, and total mortality went down. But in the group that had just estrogen alone, those women actually did not get an increase in breast cancer. So this was a basis now for studying further to find out what is the safe thing to give women to relieve their distress and to keep them safe. Now, you can't give hormone therapy willy-nilly. You have to screen the woman carefully. You have to get a history, you know, whether she has ever had a cancer. She has to be thoroughly examined before you do, because you have to make sure she's not incubating a cancer, breast or otherwise, known or suspected estrogen-dependent neoplasia, suspected pregnancy, undiagnosed abnormal bleeding, acute thrombophlebitis or history of thrombotic episodes, or liver disease. It's a screening process you go through. But if she's clear, it really is the most effective treatment that you can give. But you have to be aware. Now, a lot of women don't want drugs. They want natural things. So there, it is known that a number of physical therapy methods do work. So we advise women to get into some form of exercise that they like. Walking is a very good one. Yoga, reflexology, acupuncture, massage therapy. And maybe other things that I'm not going to mention. I can't mention everyone. Sorry about that. And the diet can be also helpful, because some plants have what we call phytoestrogens or plant estrogens. And these estrogens are not as powerful as the ones our bodies make or the ones the drug companies make, but they may just give enough to relieve some of the discomfort the woman has. And I put a list there. It's found in soya beans, lentils, and chickpeas. Chickpeas are wonderful food. How many of you have had it just curried? Yeah, or with a little chicken or something. So you incorporate it in your diet. Flaxseed, very useful. You can have the seeds in a bottle and add it to your food. It's tasteless, it gives you good roughage, and it will help you to get some phytoestrogens. Whole grains, some fruits and vegetables. And black cohosh for years was considered a good alternative. But I noticed recently, well, in my own experience, I've not seen that it's very effective in many women. Occasionally, a woman will come in and say, "Doc, that tablet really helped me." So I mention it because occasionally it helps some women. And the red clover is the same thing. So these plants are high in phytoestrogens, and they used to be helpful. Well, it used to be the only thing. I don't know how many of you remember Lydia Pinkton, what it was, tonic. That seems to have been the only thing, and we think it had black cohosh in it, but that went out some long time ago. So these are the things. Now, because of this controversy that arose from the Women's Health Initiative study, the North American Menopause Society decided to get a group together, discuss it, and come up with a position, and to make a position statement on it. And this was revived in 2017. Now, I'm not going to go into it because it's lengthy, but if you want to, I have a few copies that I could give you. But essentially what it says is that the hormone therapy is the most effective treatment, and if you're going to use it, the woman should be less than 60 or less than 10 years from her menopause, and that you have to give a progesterone with hormone therapy to all women who have a womb, and also that the low-dose therapy is best for the female who has dyspareunia. Now, incontinence, I want to say a little bit about it because it seems to be an increasing problem as women age. We all know about what is called urge incontinence, where you get the feeling to go and you got to run, but you make it. And then you have the other type, which is the stress incontinence. If you cough or sneeze, a little leaks out. And then you have the bladder that just leaks, whether you like it or not. So it can be very annoying for women and embarrassing. Now, we have learned that these kegel exercises that we were taught It's totally wrong. You have to, there are a number of physical therapists who have done their PhD thesis on pelvic physical therapy. And they have, through them, I've come to realize that you actually have to understand how to isolate your vaginal muscles and squeeze them. This business of standing over the toilet and you try to squeeze and stop the flow of urine doesn't work. So you have to go to a trained person, a physical therapist. She'll teach you how to do it, and you do it. It takes a couple months before you begin to see the benefits, and it can work. Now, another thing that I learned recently, which I found very interesting, is that there is a doctor in Kingston, in a certain place, who learned about the O-shot. How many of you know about O-shot? The O-shot is a technique that a doctor in the United States developed using platelet-enriched plasma and injecting it into the woman at the base of the bladder through the vagina. And because the platelets are enriched with solutions that encourage the growth of collagen, and so when it's injected, the collagen fibers grow, and it seems to me it forms like a little plug, or it works on the sphincter of the bladder to advantage. Now in Jamaica, because it was developed in America and called the O-shot, the doctor here calls it the eye shot. She doesn't want to be sued. And it seems to work. I actually went to a workshop and there was a lady who touted the advantages of this. Now, a lot of women may not want to do that, so I'm recommending that they use these pads that are now available. They look like pads that you use for periods, but they have a little teardrop, one or two teardrops on it. So up to four. Well, I don't know if they go to 5 or 10, but you look for it and you decide what strength you want, whether you want a 2-drop or 3 or 4, and you use them because they will relieve you of the anxiety that may come if you go out, or you know, if you're in a situation where you can't go to the bathroom and you may leak. So those are my comments on that. Now, the long-term, as we mentioned, the early, medium, long-term effects, consequences of menopause. Changes in lipid metabolism. And when these are increased, of course, you get an increased risk for cardiovascular disease and osteoporosis. Now, I'm going to stop right here and say something because I told myself, say this early, but I'm just remembering it. And that is, the majority of women go through menopause without any major problems. It is not a disease, it's a natural transition from one stage of life to another. And it's only a small percentage of women really get, you know, have such disturbing symptoms that they need intervention. So I don't want you to go away from here thinking, if you're a young woman and you haven't reached it, oh my God, is that what I'm going to go through? It, you may just go through like a song. I know many women who one day say, hey, you know, I haven't had a period for 6 months. And then at the end of 12 months, they realize they're in menopause. A lot of women who have jobs that they're passionate about and they're working and they're enjoying their work and the children are doing well and their husband is attentive, they don't even notice it. So please don't go away from this lecture thinking this is something horrible that has been imposed upon us and, you know, it's a burden we have to endure. But I have to mention osteoporosis because it's a feature of menopause. When we're young children and we're eating, our parents, our guardians need to give us good food to eat. We need to have food that's rich in calcium so we build our bone bank. And we build our bone bank and reach its maximum when we're about age 35. And after that, we start drawing from the bank. So all those members sitting here in front of me who have children or grandchildren or influence on children, please discourage the use of soft drinks, not only for the sugar content, as we have heard many times, but because the phosphates leach calcium out of the bone. And so you will not, that child will not build a good bone bank if they feed on these soft drinks on a routine basis. Now, what is osteoporosis? Osteoporosis is really weakening of the bone mass. And estrogen is the main hormone that keeps it strong. So as the estrogen hormone level declines, we begin to lose bone. And in the first 5 years of menopause, a woman can lose quite a lot of bone. So we recommend that women within 10 years of menopause should have a bone density test. Baseline, good one, in the DEXA method, and the doctor can follow up and see how it's going. We also recommend, well, let me not jump ahead, let's go on. Well, we can leave that. This one was saying, oh my God, I'm rich. Silver in my hair, gold in the teeth, crystals in the kidney, sugar in the blood, lead in the butt, iron in the arteries, and an inexhaustible supply of natural gas. I never thought I could accumulate such wealth. So, the problem with weak bones is that they fracture. And when they fracture, many times disability follows. And we're hearing, you know, of my age group, I hear some of my colleagues have had a fall and they're now in bed. Or thank God, this is an era where you can get what they call open reduction and put in a splint of some sort, a plate, screw it up, and give you back a good femur. But sometimes it's a hip and it's not so easy. And the problem with having a fracture of the hip is a thing called emboli. Some people get a fat embolus from the bone because the inside the bone is a lot of fatty tissue of the, and so the marrow of the bone, as we call it, has a lot of fatty tissue. And sometimes a little bit of fat gets trapped and gets into the bloodstream, goes to the lung or the brain, and that's the end. Or they may have a blood clot as well. Or they go into hospital because they have this fracture. They lie in bed for a couple of days and they get pneumonia and they say goodbye. So it's not a simple thing. We really want to keep our bones strong so that we stay healthy and we have no fractures and we can run up and down. I have to know, so there are a couple of persons here who may be nearly 90, would you believe that? Who have driven themselves down here and are up and down the stairs and are fully functional and happy. So, what are the risk factors for osteoporosis? Of course, age, as you get older. Race, we find that the Asian people are more prone to osteoporosis because they're small. Body build, same thing. If you're a tall, thin person with thin bones, you're likely, more likely to get osteoporosis than if you're shorter or if you're even tall but strong. What we call a strong, husky-looking person. Diet is very important. I mentioned that if you grow up and not get enough calcium in your diet, which you get from dairy products and from green vegetables, so we have no excuse, then you will end up with thin bones. And inactivity, couch potatoes are more likely to get weak bones than people who are active. Excess alcohol, smoking, the usual culprits, cigarettes and alcohol, and certain drugs like the anti-seizure drugs. So you have to have practitioners need to have a knowledge of these drugs and what to do. So how do we prevent it? You know, it's the same thing that we say for everything. Good diet and exercise. So when we exercise, when we walk and our foot hits the pavement, that impact strengthens the bones in the lower body. And to strengthen the bones in the upper body, I recommend weights, and you don't have to spend a lot of money on it. You can use water bottles, fill them with sand, and you work out. Go up and you go out, and you do it on a regular basis, maybe 2 or 3 times a week. Yes, and also, of course, you need an adequate supply of calcium in your bodies, in your diet. Now, some women, most authorities say that women should take a calcium supplement after menopause. Some say, well, at first I'll say that the best source of calcium is food. So if you have a good diet that's rich in calcium, you probably don't need to. But if you're not sure, it's probably a good idea to take it. And fortunately, most of the tablets are combined with vitamin D3, which you definitely need to be able to push the calcium into the bone. Now, you may say, oh, I can get vitamin D3 from sunshine. Sure you can. But you need at least 15 for a hyperpigmented group. We need more than 15 minutes. Now I'm going to ask you, how many of you get about 25 minutes of sun exposure each day? Most times, we're in our houses or in an office. We go from the office to some form of transportation. The windows are tinted. We go to our destination, and we go into a building. So although we have the sunshine around us, we're really not making much use of it. So it's very important that you take some vitamin D3, and with or without the calcium. And the recommended dose now is 1,000 milligrams a day. Now, I was asked to say something about andropause. I think I'm the wrong gender. But anyway, I'll make the plunge. Andropause is supposed to represent, well, it's similar to menopause. In a way it is, but in another way it's not. It's similar in that it's the decline of the male hormone testosterone, and it has some, in a way, similar features. But it's quite different in that it's much, 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 much slower. So that whereas a woman has a landmark that tells her this is it, the man has no landmark to tell him anything. It goes on slowly and insidiously, and eventually the man begins to realize that he's having the earlier symptoms are the erectile dysfunction. Things are not as good as they used to be. So he gets worried about it. But there are other things that can cause it. To the diabetes is a very common cause. So that's what makes it difficult to be definitive. As we all know, testosterone is the hormone of desire. So when it goes down, even in women, you know, if you take out a woman's ovaries, she loses her testosterone, and that can affect her libido. So it's a very valuable, all these hormones are priceless. There's also decline in muscle mass and strength. There may be some baldness, male pattern baldness, increase in body fat, which happens on both sides. Women also have this retention of fat, and we'll talk about the fat a little more from this. And they also have a decrease in bone mass. Well, what I think most people don't know is that 10% of men develop hot flashes. Yeah, they do, and you see it. And men suffer from another thing. Women also suffer from something similar. Body image. Ugh. The six-pack doesn't look the same again. I'm getting gray at the sides. I don't look so handsome as I used to. My sexual prowess is going downhill. Then I begin to think, what have I achieved in life? I wanted to be a lawyer, and boy, I never made it as a clerk. And, you know, they go on and they begin to evaluate their lives, and all these unfulfilled expectations. No, I'm not saying everybody. They're, you know, most men are satisfied with their progress in life, but some do have that problem. And some of them, frankly, have what we call a midlife crisis. That is another story. It can go on for a long time where they begin to look at their lives and realize they're getting older and they don't want to get older. They want to stay young. So they look around and they see a nice, sharp-looking girl, lovely legs and high-heeled shoes. Oh, my gosh, and she has a lovely smile. Huh, I think I'll just talk to her. So the next thing they know, they're in a relationship with a younger woman. The wife is now rejected. She's been with them 20, 30 years. And the girl and himself, oh, yes, they get a sports car to go with this. So he buys the sports car, puts a lovely girl in it, and they go and have a wonderful time. And then gradually, his sexual prowess is not so good. And the young girl who is expecting stars, they begin to be. So then he goes back, he reassesses again. And he thinks again, and he says, you know, the wife wasn't so bad after all. She used to make my meals. She would listen to me. She would, you know, take care of me, see that my clothes look nice. In fact, she takes such good care of me, and I look so nice that the girls think I was really hot. So, and it takes them a while to think the whole thing through. Sometimes they lose their marriages, and sometimes they come home, and they're wiser. So that's all I'm going to say about menopause. How much time I have left? I need about 10 or 15 minutes. All right, so now we come to the other topic, which is called menopause and diabetes. And there are some links there, which we only sort of began to think about fairly recently. And these links are, both of them come on around midlife, both of them. And for the menopausal woman, the decline in estrogen causes a redistribution of body fat. Oh, we hate when we lose estrogen. Because what happens, instead of getting this nice rounded hip and a nice protruding bottom, we begin to get fat in the middle, and that fat, some of it gets deposited intra-abdominally. That's the problem with it. It's deposited there, and that abdominal fat increases insulin resistance. That horrible phrase, insulin resistance, which we know is the doorway to diabetes and dyslipidemia as well, which comes with the menopause. And so that's one of the links we have learned. The other link we have learned is that, oh, I like this one. The older you get, the tougher it is to lose weight, because by then your body and your fat are really good friends. How many of us feel that way? All right. So the changes in blood glucose level occur during the menopause transition. The hormones wax and wane. They go up and down. And because they do that, they influence the blood sugar levels. So a woman going through menopause, who is also a diabetic, may say, what is happening here? I used to, you know, be controlled. My fastings used to be 6.2, and now I'm getting 7.5. So the woman who is knowledgeable and interested in maintaining good blood sugar control will have to measure her blood sugar more frequently and make the necessary adjustments to keep her blood sugar, keep her diabetes controlled. So they do become more unpredictable. Now, the weight gain that occurs with women in menopause can also increase the need for dose adjustment. As a woman puts on weight, it affects her blood sugar levels, and she may have to make adjustments again. So it's similar to the hormone levels fluctuating and the fat that's accumulating in the wrong place. Another thing we found is that another link is that women with who suffer from night sweats, and again, they're disturbed 2-3 times per night. This sleep deprivation can cause difficulty in controlling blood sugar levels. And a common one, which I think most of us are aware of, is infection. If your blood sugar is high, it makes a perfect environment for bacteria who would normally pass and go along their way to stop and say, hey, this is a nice, comfortable zone, let me rest here a while. So you'll find that the bacteria that in the urine, because bacteria comes into our urinary passage, but because we're healthy, we overcome it, flush it out, and it goes on its way. So the high blood sugar level predisposes to urinary and vaginal infections. That's in diabetes. In estrogen deficiency, there again, the pelvic organs are not as robust as they used to be. So there is an increased risk for bacteria and yeast in the vaginal area. So there again is that link. So when a woman comes and she has frequent urinary tract infections and you haven't diagnosed diabetes, you need to look for it. And if you haven't diagnosed dyspareunia or vaginal dryness, you need to discuss that as well. Now, another thing we find is that we spoke about hot flashes, so we know that some women sweat a lot during the transition. And also some diabetic women sweat profusely. They come into your office and they get on the examining bed and they have to be mopping their brow and they're really sweaty. So you need to think about, is this diabetes or is this due to the hormone change? And we know that in diabetes, you can have autonomic neuropathy. So the autonomic system doesn't work as well as it used to, and the woman gets these terrible sweats that are very annoying to her. So in the first case, if the woman has excessive sweating because her estrogen levels are low, you can top them up with hormone therapy, or you can control them with some antidepressant drugs, which work quite well. And if, of course, what you want to do is avoid the woman having the complications of autonomic neuropathy by keeping her blood sugar tightly controlled. Everything in diabetes is about tight control. That is the crux of the matter. We have to help our patients to get there. We have to encourage them. We have to tell them that they need not feel defeated. They can manage diabetes. It can be managed with some encouragement and with their compliance that they really take their medications. But you know, I have found that life is not so easy for a lot of people. They have to leave home early. They have to eat a box lunch, which has a mountain of rice. They go home late. They have a heavy dinner and they go to bed. So we need to help them by trying to listen to them, hear what their lifestyle is like, and see how you can help them to squeeze in a little exercise, how you can help them. I recommend a lot of times that the dinner that's cooked for night use can be taken to work and eaten as a lunch. And then when they go home at night and it's late, they have a light meal. It's very, very important to eat lightly at night. Not only diabetics, all of us, if we don't want to get a punch, because that is where major problem lies. Eating late, having a big meal full of calories, and then going to snooze. So we have to do our best to try and encourage the diabetics. And the sexual problems, again, there's a link. Because diabetes can damage the nerves of the cells that line the vagina. So if you lose your nerves, what happens? You don't have the same feeling. So these women complain about they lack arousal. They have difficulty in getting aroused, and they have difficulty reaching orgasm. So men need to hear this, because many times, you know, the man begins to think, what's wrong with this woman? She's not responding as she used to be,
as I told you before, the first thing they think of is she has another lover. And if they understood what was happening, you can accommodate it. There are things that could be done to help. Counseling is one that would be useful. And of course, the genitourinary syndrome of menopause can compound the problem, because if you have an insensitive vagina and a dry one, no lubrication or very little, you can see how it compounds the problem. So those are the sort of links we have found between diabetes and menopause. And I think I'm on my last slide. No, okay. This is just a leftover from the Women's Health Initiative study, where although they found several awful things like the increased breast cancer, they actually observed that hormone therapy significantly reduced the diagnosis of new onset type 2 diabetics. It's an interesting observation, but it's not a reason for giving women hormone therapy to prevent diabetes. But it's interesting. So I'm closing with this slide that practitioners need to be aware that at midlife, female patients may present with many confounding symptoms of both diabetes and menopause. So, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your attention. That's all I have to say.
Ladies and gentlemen, if there are any questions from the floor, we invite you to join us at the mic. Yes, Dr. Bailey.
Is it working? Dr. Fee, I'd just like to congratulate you on an excellent paper.
Thank you.
What I particularly like about your paper is that it prepares the audience to listen to my paper this afternoon.
I knew there was a catch.
But there's an interesting point I want to emphasize with respect to your paper, is with respect to the I shot or the O shot. It has been shown quite clearly that postmenopausal women who is given the O shot in the G spot, there are a lot of acronyms, the G and the I and so on. Once they get the O shot in the G spot, their lives are transformed. They're never the same. Their partners can take them to places where they've never been. It has also been shown that for women postmenopausal who have clitoral atrophy, that if they're given the O shot, the clitoris enlarges and become hypersensitive. And again, they take to places that they've never been.
True. Because a little of the eye shot goes into that same spot.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. That was an excellent presentation.
Congratulations.
Can I ask you to comment on a couple of things? There is a situation now. Should I use hormone replacement for my patients with menopause? Well, the most effective way is to use it. That's the guidelines from NICE, London. The question is, what are the situations where it's contraindicated? For example, breast cancer, etc. Can you help us?
I hope I heard you right. You're asking how to use hormone therapy?
No, contraindications.
Sorry?
Where I should not.
Oh, the contraindications. The patient has to be thoroughly screened. You have to get a history of whether they've ever had any thrombotic episodes, if they've ever had liver disease. You have to get a history if they've ever taken the oral contraceptive pill and had any adverse reactions. If they have a uterus, are they incubating breast cancer? Are they incubating any estrogen sensitive neoplasia? You have to go through that list. And then if the patient has never had any of those and their symptoms are so severe that they need relief, you think about it. Then you think, what's the best thing to do? The best form, the most physiological way, is to give it in patches. And as I was saying earlier, they have withdrawn the patches from Jamaica. We are left with a few tablets. And so that is part of the problem. We can still give it safely, but we have to discuss with the woman. This is not a decision the doctor makes on his own, his or her own. You discuss with the woman what is possible and convenient and the patient feels comfortable with. So that if she has a uterus, you've got to give her progesterone, combined. And it can be done in different ways. Many different cycles. You can give it continuously. You can give estrogen for 3 months and then drop in the progesterone so she has infrequent bleeding. So there are ways in which you have to choose the lowest dose you can find, and you have to monitor the patient throughout the whole process. Every year you have to do a routine check, breast, pelvic, the whole body, so that you, if anything that was missed earlier, you pick it up early. So it has a responsibility, but it really has great blessings.
Thank you.
And what was the other question?
And part of the same that you are helping us. Most of the patients with diabetes have liver disease. For example, non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. Nearly 50% of the people have it. Should we give hormone therapy for them or should we not?
Well, if the patient has liver disease, you can't. But I wouldn't mind if somebody else helped me. Professor Pasco, right? Did I see her in the audience? Do 50% of diabetics have liver disease? I wasn't aware of such a high prevalence.
Dr. Raju is talking about the fatty liver syndrome that we see in persons who have diabetes. And I wouldn't call it a liver disease per se. It is a precursor for cirrhosis. But I would not say that the prevalence is as high as 50%. All persons with type 2 diabetes should be screened for this liver disease. And if fatty liver is something that they have, we ask them to lose weight, or we use insulin sensitizers such as metformin or thiazolidinone such as pioglitazone. And really, reviewing the liver function in all diabetics is important, because many drugs that we use in diabetes are in fact metabolized by the liver.
Yes.
But I don't think that the prevalence is as high as what he has suggested.
Thank you.
The liver disease is an epidemic. It's a ticking time bomb. In Mandeville, where I practice, I see sometimes more than 50% of the patients have non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. The most common abnormality in the blood tests that we see today worldwide, including Jamaica probably, is elevated liver enzymes, ALT, AST, the cytosolic and mitochondrial enzymes. Slight elevations are brushed aside, but that is fatty liver. And that is more common, more dangerous than the diabetes itself.
Well, my aunt...
Away from that, in terms of osteoporosis, in menopause and after menopause, whatever happens, it happens in the first few years, then the longer years coming up. Can you comment on that? Because osteoporosis...
I haven't really heard clearly. Can somebody who heard just tell me? I really didn't hear.
Yeah, the point I'm trying to put it across is this. Osteoporosis is common,
yes,
in postmenopausal women.
Yes.
Let us say 25 years from age 50, 60, 70 years and so on. Most of it happens in the first few years.
Yes.
So what's the point in taking care of it at age 60 or 70 and leaving it at 50, as you said?
No, I did mention that.
No, you mentioned good. You mentioned very important point.
You're reinforcing it.
I agree, and I'm grateful that you mentioned.
Yes, it's very important.
Very, very, very important.
Very important. And I agree with you. Why wait till you've had it? You need to have a test done. The American Orthopedic Society says 10 years from menopause. But if you have had a diet that's low in calcium, if you have had, let's say you were an athlete, you trained vigorously in your youth, so that you ended up with a period of amenorrhea, you know your bone density is not going to be good. Well, you won't know, or there's a potential for you to have a low bone density because you have not, the menstruation indicates that your estrogen levels are good. So if you train so hard that you lose your periods, that means your estrogen levels have fallen. And that means that you could develop soft bones. So those women need to have their bone density done at a much earlier age. I would say within 5 years of menopause. Any person who has had something that interfered with their estrogen and also their diet, their intake, should have an earlier bone density done as a baseline. Then you see what happens after that. You may have to do it every year, every 2 years, every 5 years, depending on the state that it is, the reading that you have gotten, your T and Z scores.
Sure.
Thank you.
Another point, and SSRI and SNRI in the management of hot flashes. The American College of Gynecologists and Obstetricians in menopausal women recommend, for example, SSRI, small dose, and it seems to help in 50-60% of the patients. That's the guidelines released 2 years ago. How is your experience, your own experience? SSRIs, hot flashes.
SNR, I haven't heard again, but I think you're asking about the antidepressants that are useful. Yes, SNRIs, in low dose.
Yeah.
Effexor is a good one to choose.
Sure.
Yes.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Good morning, Prof. Whitbourne. Thank you so much for our comprehensive presentation. Just a quick comment. You spoke about the topical hormones and the fact that we don't have any here now. There is a compounding pharmacist that is supposed to be coming to Jamaica. She currently works out of the United States. We can get medication from her, so you can actually compound both the topical estrogen as well as estrogen and progesterones at the different concentrations. Her name is Dr. Adelaide Harpo. I can share the email address with you guys later if you guys want it.
No, I wanted to respond to that because that is a bit of a, what shall I say? The North American Menopause Society, again, the World Authority on Menopause, though that whole thing about bioidentical hormones, I think that's what you're talking about. Some time ago, it emerged. I think this girl, Susan Summer, she wrote a book how she has been on this bioidentical hormones and she had a wonderful time. And later, I think she ended up with breast cancer. Now, the bioidentical hormones have the same disadvantages and risks of the drugs that the drug houses put out, the standard brand drugs. Mm-hmm. And they do not usually tell the patient that. They tell the patient, this is the exact hormone that your body makes. And it is not.
No,
it's a synthetic hormone, just like permethrin. Not sempermarin is not synthetic, sorry. Various estradiol and different forms of estrogen. So the other thing that bothers us about that is that the practitioners who use it, they take samples from the saliva, which is a very unreliable way to assess hormone levels. And based on the results they get, they make up a prescription, so much estrogen, so much progesterone,
so much
testosterone if needed. They give it to these pharmacies. They're compounded. The FDA doesn't approve of them. There's no FDA approval on it. And it's really not approved in the best circles, I would say. Now, I know that people are using it. I don't really have a major problem except that I'd prefer to use blood levels to assess the status of the hormones. And I also think that they ought to level with the patient, that they need to have these checks. I don't know if they do, but I haven't heard. They need to do the checks that the physician who puts a patient on a brand drug has to do to ensure the safety of the patient.
But still, I'm glad to hear, and I would like to know more about it and meet with the people, because I'd want to know who is monitoring and where the standards, who is checking these standards.
Sure.
Thank you very much.
Will do.
But there's a big temptation for people to just go and get something, a cream, and they rub it here and they rub it there. You know, it has to be standardized to be for the physician who makes these prescriptions to feel safe for the patient's benefit.
Dr. Morrison?
Yes?
I love your presentation.
Thank you.
It prepares me as a young man as to some of the challenges I'll face. But my question to you, what is your view on the use of, let's say, marijuana during menopause?
Marijuana during menopause? Well, you know, I have mixed views on marijuana. I definitely, the good thing I should back up and say is that menopause occurs in midlife women, not teenagers, because we definitely do not agree with marijuana being given to children or teenagers. They say up to age 25. It depends on the extent of usage. If a woman took a joint, a spliff, and she felt less irritable, and she functioned well in her home, as some people do, I guess it wouldn't harm her. But if the one spliff is going to lead to 2 and 3, and she wants to sleep all day and do nothing, no housework, blah, 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 I don't think it would be a good idea.
All right, thank you.
Because there are men who tell me they take a spliff at the end of the day. They work a full productive day. They go home and have a spliff, and it relaxes them, and they don't seem to come to any harm, so I don't know. And I would appreciate any other comments if anybody thinks this is harmful.
I have 2 patients who have been taking marijuana the last 3-4 years. Both are very productive, very hardworking, very decent women. And both of them, God's blessing them, and they take 1 or 2 spliffs they take. Very good, very helpful. I haven't seen any harmful effects of marijuana in anybody who takes it. Most of my patients, 20-30% of my patients have taken it. Non-menopausal, men, women, all of them. Well, I close by saying, marijuana na kill nobody. And Matahan, Craven here, Matahan, kill everybody.
Somebody has to translate. I didn't hear that, but I think we have to stop. What did you say? Not kill nobody. That's it.
Well, that is a quite humorous note to end on. And before I ask you for another rousing round of applause for our presenter, I'm going to ask you for sentimental and symbolic leave. And I'm going to ask Professor Morrison to come and present to his wife for a second time her plaque for an outstanding pioneering service to midlife health in Jamaica. And he's right there. Please don't be shy, Prof. And while Professor is approaching, I would like to say, I seldom call myself a media practitioner, but I guess I am. Healthcare, the media could do a lot more for healthcare, and at CVM Television, we do have a lifestyle and entertainment segment in our primetime news. So if you do have a topic which you would like to air on our program, I'm sure that we'd be very happy to partner with you in your professional, individual, and national endeavors to explore and remedy. Thank you. Here is Professor. Would you like to say something?
No.
The audience is requesting a kiss, Professor. It can be on the cheek if you wish. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, and I am told that it is now time for a coffee break. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for your wonderful energy and listening so intently. God bless you.